Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Radiorama, where we primarily work on radios, stereos, record players, and other stuff that runs on glowing vacuum tubes from the 1920s through about the 1960s. And today I have a Westinghouse model H504P4. It's either a battery or a AC-powered set, and it's remarkably compact for a radio in general. Let's take a look. It probably runs on some crazy batteries, like either 90 volt or 60 volt batteries. Get it open here. Here we go. All right, so here's the innards. Obviously, there is a, look at this. Someone paid 20 bucks for it back. It actually still does work, and I think it's not been worked on. Let's see. This has four tubes in a solid state, probably a selenium rectifier inside. And here's the tube lineup. 3V4 for the output, and then the IF tubes. IF and RF are 1U5, 1U4, and 1R5. It says that it could have run on two different batteries. It was 1.5 volts, which is essentially the filament voltage, and then I wonder how big that battery was. I'm not familiar with that. The second one is a 67.5 volt battery. And that's your B+. And what they would do is they knew that the filaments would drain the battery a lot quicker. So they have a separate battery, which was like a lot cheaper, which you could get from the grocery store or whatever. And then the much bigger battery, the higher voltage one, could last for, I've seen some of them that are over 100 hours or more. So you would not replace that one much. You'd replace the other one for the filaments. And it also is got an AC cord. Cord's a little stiff in it. I'm not sure if I'm going to keep that. When you can do that and it doesn't really bounce back, that's an indicator that your rubber is turning into a different element. Now, since it already works, and actually I've already finished another restoration project, I'm going to do this backwards. Whoops. This case has got a lot of scratches in it, and people won't be pleased with how that looks. And so what I'm going to do is take the chassis out, and I'm going to go to work on the cabinet with some Novus number 2 plastic polish. The other issue I have here, and I need to figure out a way to make this more secure, is when I got this handle was broken, so I glued it back together with super glue. But I mean, that's not possibly going to work. I mean, that's such a skinny piece. So what I'm thinking about doing is mounting a discrete metal plate underneath here, glue it on there so that there's more structural support there. Either that, worse comes down to worse, I'll just have to tell the future owner, don't carry it by the handle, even though they'll do it and they'll break it and it'll drop, and that'd be a pity. So let's take the guts out and I will get to work polishing the case. All right, well, I've got the chassis uninstalled, and you know what, I just kind of have to admit that I'm a little impressed by this. Look at this. It's such a crazy feat of product design. You've got the speaker, and then in front, I've never seen this before, in front of the speaker is the tuning condenser. Then wrapped around that is this metal cowling, and then the electronics are just built all around it. Like, talk about clever. Then, of course, this consumer side is where all the tubes are, and they're all lined up in a nice, neat row. Very tidy little chassis, I must say. I'm very intrigued by the fact that it still works even though nothing's been done to it. That's the original electrolytic. And you see it's all like squished like that from that mount. Usually that damages them and like they will hum like a motherfucker, but I guess somehow that one did not get affected by that. But we'll need to replace all four of these values. We have a 60, a 40, and a 250 microfarad. I'm assuming that 250 is probably like 10, 15 volts or something like that. It's probably acting more like a bias than anything. And this little blue thing over here, that is the oh-so-infamous selenium rectifier. I'm not sure if I'll replace that or not. It doesn't look like this thing's had a lot of use. We have all of the original Westinghouse tubes. And trust me, these one-filament tubes usually did not have as long of a life expectancy as their higher voltage brethren. So the fact that they're all original makes me think, again, more of an indicator that this was kind of not used all that much. So that rectifier might be just fine. All right, so like I said, I don't really feel like working on the electronics for the rest of the evening, so I'm going to polish this case. And my favorite product of all time for plastic polish is this product called Novus Number 2. It kind of looks like peanut butter when it comes out of the jug. And you just use old rags. They have a bunch of socks and old underwear and stuff like that. You just like go with a circular kind of motion here. Just take your time, and if you are patient, you'll be well rewarded. This should look like a mirror when we're done versus it being all like abraded up here. Welcome back to day two of working on the little Westinghouse portable. And this is the result after spending a copious amount of time with the Novus Number 2 plastic polish. And the other thing you do that I can't really show you because I already clamped it in there, I put a metal plate discreetly underneath the metal handle so that even though I've super glued the handle, I think it needs more structural rigidity there. Now, let's move on to the chassis. And the first thing, that I'm going to do is replace this multi-section electrolytic capacitor. It has three values inside. 60 microfarad, 40 microfarad, and 250 microfarad. And they're rated at 150 each, except for that 250, which is only like 15 volts. That's probably a bias cap. And it says, here's the color codes, red, green, and yellow, and black is common negative. Black is obvious, green is obvious. And just from my experience, I can usually tell which is which. I know that's red, that's just faded red, and that's yellow. The other thing too is look at your color codes here. Yellow is only 15 volts. It would definitely not be going off of the back of the rectifier here. If I put 15 volts on that, that would explode dramatically. So we know that's red just by default of its function. And then of course we have our negative here. And so what we have are three individual electrolytics. I have 100 microfarad cap for the 60. I'm thinking I could probably get away with 47, but whatever. More filtering, that's fine. Then we have a 47 microfarad guy for the 40 microfarad value. I have a 220 volt one, or 220 microfarad cap for the 250. I mean, you can be pretty loosey-goosey. I mean, don't go nuts, but The rule of thumb is generally you want your electrolytics to be at or greater. When it comes to the low voltage stuff, I don't sweat it too much. But these things are not super complicated, high precision machines. So what you do is you replace each of these individual wires, these three colored wires, with the positives of each one of these electrolytics. And then their negative, which is this stripe here. They all have a stripe. That's your negative. They're going to be common, meaning they all share the same negative, which is this black wire right here. And probably what I'll do is I'm going to hang the new capacitors here and there, wherever they will fit, and then just run jumpers from the negative. Because they don't make these multi-section caps anymore, but they do make these individuals, and so we just need to like be creative with where we put them. So let's snip these wires off and install these electrolytics, and we'll do another test to make sure the set is still working. All right, well, we've got our electrolytics installed. Got one here, two over here with their negatives tied together. And you got to make sure and keep the wire kind of tight because all this fits into a little case. Battery. My phone says it's about to run out, so I need to do this quickly.
Because as it devolves, you have no answers. A kid that's not ready, a guy that...
It still works. So we need to replace these two guys, and let's see if it's still recording. I think it is. Yay! All right, welcome back to day two of working on a little portable Emerson. And the next thing I'm going to do is replace this guy. This is an earlier solid-state rectifier. It's a selenium sulfide or oxide of some sort. And these do, over time, eventually build up enough resistance to where they can fail, and if they do, they stink super bad, and it's slightly toxic, so it's not a good thing to have happen. Luckily, they stink so bad you'll It'll probably be outside of your house as soon as it happens. We're going to replace that with a modern silicone diode, which is this little guy here. And because this is more efficient than this guy, we need to kind of compensate for that by putting a little bit of resistance in conjunction with that diode. I usually put a 50 ohm resistor in conjunction with it. I found a 47 in my stash that's close enough. And the way that this looks, if you were to draw it out in a schematic, it looks like this. The anode of the diode is your going to your positive, and your resistor is in front of that. That's your positive, and then your negative is the back end of the diode. And we're going to mount it here on this little handy-dandy terminal strip, which will probably fit just perfectly right there. So let's take that out of there and observing where this stuff attaches to it. And that then we'll be on our way to having the electronics part of this set done. And then I'll do what I usually do, which is add an audio input function so that you can run audio into the set as well as having radio. Okie dokie, so we've got the new solid state diode installed here. It's pretty hard to film because it's so teeny. And we have our positive side and then our negative side back here. Also installed a new cord because the old one was pretty stiff. Now, I am somewhat dyslexic in some cases, and so I've on occasion wired the diode in backwards. And that will spectacularly fail. So let's go ahead and test it out here. Okay, well, the Quack Medicine Radio Show comes in loud and clear, so obviously it works. So the last thing I'm going to do is add the aforementioned audio input. And this is going to be kind of tricky on this one because we have a cover that goes over the volume control. Maybe I could wire it underneath, because here's the leads coming out of that guy, and what I need to do is find the lead that goes to the first IF can. Where are those IF cans at? These two teeny little guys over here. And I'm not going to bore you guys with this. I will find it, but we're going to have to tack into the top end of the volume pot for our incoming audio signal. And I've had a few people ask, where do I get my isolation transformers? This is what I use to run the audio through, so you don't have any risk of having current coming from the radio chassis to the incoming line. I order these from Alibaba. I order them about 100 at a time. Now, if you're not going to do this very often, here's the thing. You can, if you get a wall wart, and let's say it's a wall wart where 120 volts goes in and like 12 volts comes out, you can crack those open and use those. They'll do exactly the same thing, because this is all that is. It's just a transformer that has 120 in and 12 volts out on the secondary. And so the primary, this goes to the IF, or the top of the volume, and then your audio comes in through the secondary. Hope that makes sense. One day I'm going to crack open a wall wart so I can show you, because it's the same thing, it's just they're physically bigger. And I like to get these as small as I possibly can, so that I can fit them, especially in weird chassis like this where everything's squished together. So I will show you how to do that. I'm going to go ahead and just install it, and then I'll show the after, the before and after of that. Sorry, I stayed up pretty late last night. It's Halloween around here. I'm a little tired. Anyway, I'll install the audio input, and we also need to install a switch that turns the IF signal off so that we can turn the radio signal on and off so that we'd have uninterrupted audio for when the user wants to just listen to audio and not radio. Okay, this took a little more time than I thought. I had a hard time routing the wiring and everything to the volume control. But I did, and so now we have the isolation transformer installed, and we have on the primary side going to the pot a 0.02 cap and half the value of the volume control. In this case it's about 270K. And then we have a right and left channels from our incoming audio line going through two resistors, and they join together on one side. Then the other side is negative. I'm probably going to put hot glue over the top of this just to make sure nothing's going to come loose or touch once it's stuffed back in the case. So I have the IF signal detached from the IF can here. So I have to add a switch for that to restore audio from radio. But I'm going to, go ahead and plug it in and we can demonstrate. Nope, you're not going to win any audio contests, but that's kind of not the point. It's just that we're giving this radio the ability to be used more than just a radio. Someone could maybe put it in their kitchen or take it on a picnic or something like that and run whatever they want to listen to it versus being stuck with just AM, which these days doesn't really have much music on it anymore. So it kind of adds a little more utility. So I'm going to run the switch wire, glob this up with glue, and run the switch out the back of the set and button it up, and I think we'll be done. All right, so I managed to cram everything back into this teeny little case, and I've been having it play here for about an hour. Usually I like to let electronics that have been out of service for who knows how long kind of sit for a while and get warmed up enough to where anything that could fail due to temperature could fail. So right now I've got my little Bluetooth hockey puck running through it. Yeah, it works pretty well. Anyway, that's it for this Halloween episode of Radiorama. Even though when it gets broadcast, it won't be Halloween anymore. But if you are watching it, I hope you had a good Halloween anyway. Anyway, if you like what you saw and you have any questions or comments, you can always leave those in the comment section down below. And until the next time that a piece of obsolete electronic thingy comes across my bench, we'll see you next time.